I'm a postdoc at UC Berkeley's AMP Lab. We are the people behind Spark and various other awesome open source projects. And I'm going to be talking about kind of efforts that we've been engaged in to try and make Python scale, not just for people like us who like building distributed systems, whether or not I'm in that category, you'll have to decide at the end, but also for all of our collaborators. And before we get started, obviously, I want to say thank you to Continuum. And I really want to stress that, you know, I don't think I'm here in a fan of Python because Continuum is nice to me. Rather, I think I'm here because I've loved them forever. And I found this email from Travis in my inbox back in 2006, where he was talking about releasing RC2 of NumPy. And this is actually just as far back as my email goes. I started using Python when I was an undergrad at MIT back in the day. My then best friend was like, stop writing C++. There's a better way, get rid of your MATLAB. And you know, periodically, with what seems to be basically once or twice a year, I tweet out something insane about the degree to which I love Anaconda. And I don't know if for people who are new to the Python ecosystem, it actually used to be the case that packaging with Python and getting Python packages to run on your machine, especially libraries like NumPy and SciPy, which had a substantial compiled component, was an incredible challenge. And nowadays, the first thing I tell every collaborator, every new student who comes into our lab, is download Anaconda. And it's actually gotten to the point where my advisor, Ben Recht, originally was a little bit skeptical, and now he basically won't answer people's questions in the lab unless they've installed Anaconda. So what do I work on? I work on big data. And this is kind of, I'm very interested in the kind of applications of data science for science, or as we used to just call it, science. And we work at a couple of domains, right? We work with, say, nearby stars or the sun. We work with neurons, and we work with nuclei. And the interesting thing about these application domains here is that we can kind of examine them across multiple scales, right? We can think about what is the size, right? So in the case of the sun, it's about 10 to the 9 meters in diameter. We only really have one nearby. I think that might be a good thing. And observatories like the Solar Dynamics Observatory are generating about 2 petabytes of data in their archive, right? So it's 1.5 terabytes of data per day. On the neuroscience side, we're very interested in how large numbers of neurons combine to give rise to behavior, to give rise to cognition, to influence things like neurodegenerative diseases. And there, you know, each neuron is about 10 to the negative 5 meters in diameter, right? Cell body is about 10 microns. And the average human brain has roughly 100 billion of them, right? Or 10 to the 11. And if we were to actually record or observe the activity of all of those, we'd be generating about 12 terabytes a second. Unless you think that sounds like an insane goal, the Obama administration announced a few years ago an effort to try and acquire all of this data, the Brain Initiative. And we're actually currently on a DARPA project that's trying to get to the point where we can observe 1 million neurons at once. And more recently, we've even gotten interested in measuring nuclear properties, right? So a nucleus about 10 to the negative 14 meters, and they're generated, you have maybe 10 to the 26 of them in a brain, and those data rate volumes are a little intense, and we're not even sure what we're gonna be able to pull out there. But as an example, this is the sun. So this is what the sun looks like. And this is roughly to scale, and there you are there. And the diagram, the text on the left, or on the right rather, is incorrect. This is not actually the sun in UV. This is the sun in visible light. And this is what the sun would look like if you stared at it on a regular day. Do not recommend doing that. Use special equipment. But if you look at the sun in ultraviolet, right, this is what the sun looks like. The sun is generating so much energy at such an incredible rate that most of the interesting solar activity that's going on is actually in the ultraviolet regime. And what you're watching here is an active region of the sun, a region of kind of coiled, complicated magnetic activity in different ultraviolet bands here. And those active regions give rise to what are called solar flares. And so part of what we're using Python for is to take in this massive data stream from the Solar Dynamics Observatory and try and predict these explosions on the surface of the sun that ultimately do things like damage Earth satellites and corrupt Earth power systems. Additionally, we're very interested in kind of neuroscience at all scales, right? So we go from kind of the biggest thing in the solar system to something kind of the size that we're all carrying around with us. And the interesting thing about neuroscience is that you can imagine trying to study a brain at multiple levels, right? You can try and understand the wiring diagram inside kind of an entire brain at, let's say, the networking level, right? So this is diffuse optical, or this is rather diffuse intensor imaging where you measure the bundles of neurons, or bundles of axons, as they connect one part of the brain to the other. So you can think of this kind of like the data center eye view of a human brain, and we can obtain all of this data non-invasively, which I'm grateful for. We can then start looking at individual cells, right? So again, as I said, there's 80 to 100 billion cells, and there's all these amazing technologies that are being developed to let us look at those, and even go down to electron microscopy, where we can say, hey, look, we can look at individual synapses and build up kind of complete circuit diagrams of how these systems work. Again, all using Python. In fact, I want neuroscience data so badly that since a lot of this big neuroscience data doesn't exist yet, we started faking it, right? So we took a MOS 6502 from an original Atari and reconstructed its schematic diagram, got it to engage in some so-called behaviors the way you might get a mouse or a graduate student to do, and then attempted to reconstruct and analyze all of that neural, quote, neural activity, right? We had a paper recently. Again, this has all been in Python. And part of the motivation there was, well, we don't have this kind of big neuroscience data yet, but we can kind of fake it, and we're really curious if our tools are going to be there ready. So these are the sorts of projects we're working on. And the I want more. And in particular, one of the things that we're very interested in is acquiring more data computationally. So we're starting to try and design our instruments to work better via algorithms. Adaptive optics is this example where you can actually use a deformable mirror when you're staring at things from a ground-based telescope and correct for the aberrations that the atmosphere introduces. Super resolution microscopy, where you take a blurry image like on the left and using a bunch of computational algorithms, again, mostly written in Python, you can see individual molecules. Tomography, where rather than looking at traditional X-rays, you can do three-dimensional CT reconstructions. And even ultimately phase contrast microscopy, where you can take cells that are virtually invisible. And by designing your instrument in a way that it extracts information that's valuable for the algorithm, not for the person, see more. So we're building up all of this data, and it's gotten very exciting. But I work with a lot of physicists, and how do you get these busy physicists and electrical engineers to give up MATLAB? Or similarly, in the case of the astronomers, they use something called IDL, which is like MATLAB, but worse in every way. How do you get them to stop using these languages? You know, remember, like many of you, they have decades of knowledge and of code that they've put together to try and do their science. And a lot of that code is, you know, some, in some places, the only knowledge about how to run or work with a particular algorithm lives in some piece of code that some graduate student wrote 15 years ago before getting smart and going and working at a hedge fund. And so I feel like the thing you have to do is give them a hook, right? You have to say, look, Python is great, and I can sit there and I can talk about it. It's a real language, it's open source, you know, it's all these sorts of things, but they really need a new capability. And part of what motivated our current direction was recognizing that, you know, cloud computing is a thing, elasticity is a thing. We at the AMP Lab have our own cluster, but we also rely very heavily on cloud services. And we were in a group meeting where my colleague and collaborator, Shivaram, was attempting to explain to our computational imaging colleagues, so applied physicists, EEs, these sorts of people, how to use AWS. And we're going through all the different aspects of these are the instances, this is S3, this is DynamoDB, et cetera. And one of the professors of computational imaging there, Ren Ng, who you may know as the Litro founder, said, well, why is there no cloud button? And we're like, well, you know, come on. You have a computer science degree, you know this is hard. But the more we thought about it, the more we realized that for a large number of use cases, he might actually be correct, right? Maybe this is this missing thing. So there's this amazing politician, Jimmy McMillan, who used to always complain that he was the founder of the rent is too damn high party. And this made me think, well, he's right, the cloud is too damn hard. And as a measure of this, and I'm really glad this is being recorded, so this will come back and bite me, I'm sure. Less than half the grad students in the AMP Lab have ever written a Spark or Hadoop job. These are not like the first years who come out, you know, and are very green. These are the, you know, fourth year, fifth year Mike Jordan PhDs in theoretical machine learning who write a lot of code. But their answer to, hey, look, a lot of that, most of that code actually is in Python. Their answer to, hey, look, I need more cores or whatever, is to actually let their laptop turn a little bit larger, longer. Or maybe, you know, SSH into a larger workstation. No one is actually, or at least the majority of people are not using this distributed computing framework that we had a role in building. So how do we fix that? I hate computers. every time I have to remember that the thing I'm working with is a physical device with kind of large amounts of state that I don't necessarily control, I get very frustrated. And you can see this. This is from ec2instances.info. It's the easy Amazon EC2 instance comparison. And it lists a tremendous number of options that Amazon provides you. Now, I love Amazon. I'm mostly talking about Amazon here because they gave us the largest grant, and so we use them the most. But all of the cloud computing providers have this tremendous complexity. And this complexity is partly because as cloud infrastructure has grown, it's replaced a lot of existing data center infrastructure. And that in some sense requires lots of options. And you know, you're not just sitting there deciding between the two different sedans, but in fact, you're picking out the parts for your car. But there's all these different options. And you know, you start off and you try and explain how to use this to someone, and you say, well, what type of instance do you want, right? What is the base image that you're going to boot up with? Do you want Ubuntu? Do you want CentOS? Do you want all these different things? And then you say, how many do you want to spin up? What size is your cluster going to be? What price do you want? Do you want to take advantage of pricing elasticity? These are all decisions you find yourself having to make. And you're like, no, why do I have to make all these stuff? And then someone's like, great, now just SSH in and start setting things up. And you're like, well, really, you told me this was going to be easy. And so what do we actually want? I would argue that what we want is a system with very little overhead for setup. I would like to be able to take one of my data science colleagues or a theoretical math graduate student who perhaps knows Python but doesn't really understand what an operating system is and get them to the point where they can use AWS, right? So basically, once someone has an AWS account, we'd like for them to have as little of effort as possible to get running with no persistent overhead, no persistent state. You don't have to keep a cluster up. You don't have to wait 10 minutes for your cluster to come up. We'd also like the users to have as little overhead as possible, right? If you have existing Python code, and I'm guessing, the majority of you in the audience have kind of large code bases that you've built internally that you would like to be able to, say, parallelize or scale that maybe don't fit very naturally into existing distributed computing frameworks. So we'd like to target you. We'd also like to target jobs that run in kind of the minutes or more regime. So there's a lot of work on, you know, what do I do if I'm actually just trying to run something like word count? How do I make those sorts of distributed system scale? We're not interested there. We're interested in this problem of you have some code, you know, it takes one coffee cup to run, and you want to run it 1,000 times, and that's a lot of coffee. So maybe you let it run overnight or over the week. We'd like to speed that up for you. I don't want to run a service, right? We don't want this to be some hosted thing that we're providing. We don't really want to offer that front end. We want to just give AWS the money directly. And finally, it has to be from a cloud provider that's likely to give us an academic grant. Now, this is more of a constraint on us than it may be on you. But while there are startups and large companies in the space that will happily, you know, you just give them your Python code and they'll figure out the problem for you. We're not in that boat. And we think that a lot of people doing kind of interesting data science research, both in the academic environment and in small and large companies, are also in that boat. So these are the things we want, right? We want limited overhead for setup. We want anyone who can write Python to be able to use it. We're targeting the minutes or more regime. We don't want to run a service, and we'd really like it to be from an existing cloud provider. So fortunately, there are two key pieces of technology that I think make this possible today. One is, of course, Anaconda, and I'm not just saying that. You'll see the important role that Anaconda plays in a bit. Another is this service developed by Amazon called AWS Lambda. And the interesting thing about Lambda is it was originally designed as a microservice framework because I'm not the only person who hates computers. What I really hate are servers, and a lot of people are in that boat. And so what AWS Lambda is designed to do is gives you a single process that will run for a max of 300 seconds on a reasonably contemporary core with roughly 512 megabytes of temporary space, 1.5 gigs of RAM, and you can run Python, Java, or Node.js code inside this little thing. Now, Amazon's original use case, as you can see from this wonderful demo of Jeff Bezos here, is that they envision this as a thing where a user uploads an image into S3, it triggers a Lambda, you can perform some sort of computation on that and sticks the results back in a database. Right? Very much these kind of tiny tasks that maybe your hosted web service can do. And we said, well, actually, and similarly, both Google and Amazon have similar function-based services. So again, this is all AWS specific. But we'd like to use that such that we can write a code like this. We can basically map across any existing Python function that we might have sitting around. And this is a nice demo. We built this package called PyWren that I'm going to talk to you about. But to achieve that kind of capability, right, we're really going to have to push Lambda. So remember, Lambda was not designed for compute, right? These microservices were designed to do little kind of one-off tasks. And we found that actually with this platform that we've built, we can get Lambda to scale kind of shockingly well, right? So because you have the ability through Amazon to say, hey, here's a function I'd like you to run, now run it 3,000 times at once, you can get kind of what we viewed in the AMP lab as kind of shocking scalability. I feel like for us to say that, that kind of means something, right? As the number of these Lambda workers scale up, we can get off of, again, vanilla Python code here, you know, 40 teraflops per second. Because a lot of our transactions are happening via Amazon's bulk object store, S3, we can get aggregate read and write speeds of 80 and 60 gigabytes per second, which is an awful lot of data to be shoving through a system running just the existing Python functions that you have lying around. And you can do a lot with this kind of framework, right? With the ability to just say, here's my arbitrary Python function. I would like to map it across some set of data or across some set of parameters. There are two kind of crucial use cases that we cared about targeting. One is anything in the ETL space, right? So pre-processing your data, featurization of images, these sorts of things. The other thing was parameter tuning, right? When we build these computational imaging algorithms, they often have hyperparameters, right? Just like in machine learning, that you need to get right for the system to actually do a good job working, right? And that way people do that right now is, you know, scikit-learn has this lovely hyperparameter tuning engine where you say, okay, these are the different values I'd like you to try. And it just runs off and tries a bunch of different ones on your laptop or on your workstation, and you, again, come back tomorrow, come back after the weekend to see what the best one is. We'd like to target that because we really believe that any job that takes kind of 5 minutes on your laptop, you should be able to run 3,000 of them in about 5 minutes. So let's look at this ETL use case. This is the one I'm going to focus on. So ImageNet is the large-scale visual recognition challenge that everyone keeps testing their deep learning algorithms on. And there's roughly 1.4, I think, million images in this data set, right? And so what we're going to do is try and featureize those images, right, with some random featureization code that we downloaded off the internet. That's how most data science seems to happen. And we're going to try and scale this up, right? So we have 1.5 million images in S3. And we're going to run through, and what you see here, which is a little bit of a complicated diagram, is our execution history, right? So what we're doing here is we're submitting those jobs, which is the list of blue dots on the left there, right? You see that we submit those fairly quickly. The wall clock time here is the total time I'm sitting there staring at my non-existent watch as a millennial, from 0 to roughly 300 seconds on the right there. And what you see happens is that the job starts, those are the green dots, right? There's some initial setup that takes some time. The compute occurs, right, which is everything between red and purple there, and then we fetch the results back. And there's a lot of jitter because, again, these microservice frameworks were not designed for this. We're really kind of abusing them. If there are people in the audience from Amazon, don't tell anyone. But what this means is that end-to-end, we can get all of this data done. And the distribution of time that those different jobs take, we can see that we're actually spending the majority of time in compute there. But this really means is we can pre-process all of ImageNet in, as I said, 5 minutes. And how does this work, right? Surely this must be magic. It's not really. This is kind of a walkthrough of what happens when you invoke one of these jobs. So it adheres to an interface that looks very much like the Python futures interface, right? So if you're using Python 3 and you're used to things like async IO, we basically just stole that interface because it's reasonably well thought out. And it also meant we had to write less documentation. We can just be like, hey, it's just like this other thing. So you can map this function over some data. And what will happen there is we're going to serialize the function in the data. One piece that I need to stress here is that this depends on a lot of powerful serialization technology that exists intrinsically to Python, and that also was developed partly as part of the Spark or the PySpark project, right? Now, Duane was talking earlier about how there's kind of this distinction between interpreted and compiled languages. One nice thing about interpreted languages is it's often very easy to, at runtime, open them up and see what their dependencies are and kind of package those all up. And so we serialize that. We do exactly that. We take your function, we take your data, and we stick that all into S3, into the object store. We invoke Lambda, right? So we tell Amazon, run one of these Lambdas. But what the Lambda really does is it pulls the job from S3. Every Lambda is, from Amazon's perspective, running the same code. And then downloads a custom Anaconda runtime that we've built, right? It invokes Python to run our code, right? You on the other end say, hey, I want the result back. So we start pulling S3. And when this is done, we pickle the result, we serialize the result, and we just stick it back in S3, and that's it, right? You could write this in a weekend. I did as well. And with that, then that result ends up being unpickled and returned to your laptop. And that's great. And this is partly what kind of dictates the scale at which these jobs work, right? We say we're targeting things that run for minutes or more, because there is some transaction overhead. But again, for most of our users, they don't care if their serial job takes twice as long as it might have otherwise, because now they can run 3,000 of them at once. And that ends up being a key enabler. That's something you can't do in IDL. That's something that is just not possible with MATLAB's existing frameworks. So this all depends largely on a bunch of sharing, of server sharing technology that's been developed over the past several years, right? So this is a brief kind of, I'll say mostly wrong, history of ways of virtualizing servers. Remember I was talking earlier about how I hate servers. So along the x-axis here is the kind of amount of overhead necessary to kind of share these sorts of resources. And on the y-axis is how isolated are they? How safe are they from one another? And you know, we all are familiar with kind of the idea of a process, right? Unix has had processes for a long time. Every time we've had time sharing systems, you know, one program's running here, the other program's running there, the operating system can put one to sleep while it runs the other one. And that all works really well up until, you know, it doesn't, and then Windows crashes because your game did the wrong thing and you missed your email. On the other end up here, and we've had this since kind of the 90s, right, you can just rent a machine, and they'll just give you, you know, there are lots of virtual hosting providers that will quite happily give you a real physical machine to SSH in. And that's, of course, super isolated. It's your own physical machine. But, you know, someone has to go out there and physically hook up a machine, or especially when they run out of them. There's tremendous transactional overhead there. Now, virtual machines really rose to prominence for consumers in the 90s, right? Technologies like VMware and Xen. And this is actually what ends up powering a lot of our existing cloud technology, where the operating system or the machines are running some sort of hypervisor, something at a lower level than your operating system. But then they can kind of switch in and out these operating systems. Again, virtual machines give you really good isolation, almost as good as physical hardware, although there are ways to break out of them. But you don't have to physically go buy new hardware. You don't have to swap out a hard drive. You don't have to do any of these things. VMs started getting hardware accelerated in kind of most recent iterations of Intel hardware. But there's really been a push for this new type of technology, which various people here I know are familiar with, called containerization. And the idea behind containerization is you can think of them kind of being like lightweight VMs. The underlying system is still running Linux, but you're given this very protective bubble, right? And container technology has really taken off. People, you know, you probably hear your cool friends talking about Docker all the time. At least that's what my cool friends in Silicon Valley talk about. And the neat thing about containers is they're like super lightweight VMs that provide process isolation, network isolation, file system isolation, and memory and CPU constraints. And what this means is that from a cloud provider's perspective, you can spin up a large number of these things and very, very quickly, on the order of, say, half a second, totally switch from running Eric's Lambda job to running someone else's Lambda job, hopefully then back to running Eric's Lambda job. So this kind of technology had this real problem, though, with us, especially with Amazon's Lambda service, in that you only had half a gig of storage locally, right? So we didn't really want an Anaconda. We wanted this kind of snake. So Leptotriphalops carile is the world's smallest snake. I learned this from a Daily Mail article, so maybe that's correct, maybe that's not. And we want our runtime, right? We want the thing that's running our Python packages to include all the dependencies that we're used to, including NumPy, SciPy, Cython, Numba, scikit-learn, Pillow, et cetera. And so what we had to do was really take existing NumPy, or existing Anaconda distribution, right, which is not a small snake, and start shrinking it down. So if you start off, this is the size of your Anaconda distribution with all these packages installed. If you just start with Miniconda and install these ones. And we had to shrink that down. So first you run conda clean. And that gets you down to about 970 megabytes. And then you go through and you just blow away the package directory because, you know what, this is a runtime. You don't really necessarily care what's in there. And maybe that gets you another 30 megabytes or so. And then you, so I think it's amazing that Anaconda ships with MKL now. That's really, the Intel's math kernel libraries are a real enabling technology for people like me who spend a lot of time doing scientific computing, because it gives you extremely fast, extremely competitive performance with no kind of mental overhead, right? But of course, Intel's MKL is designed to run well on all Intel processors. And we know very specific details about the types of processors that these lambdas are running off for. So we can delete all of the versions of MKL that aren't running on our, that aren't targeted for our processor. And that ends up giving us about down to about 670 megabytes. So we're trying to hit under 512, we're getting there. We can then strip all of the shared libraries with the, with their debugging information, right? So all of the C code that gets packaged along contains a lot of information that, if you're using a tool like GDB, will help you debug. Nope, we'll get rid of that. That gets us down to 510, we're almost there. And then if we get rid of all of the intermediary PYC files, we get down to 441 megabytes. So now we have a small snake runtime that we can ship to these lambdas and get them to run our arbitrary Python code. Now, you're saying, okay, this is great, but what if map is not enough? What if I don't just want to map over data or map over hyperparameters? And it's true, a lot of data analysis looks like this. You start with data, that's the Google image search first image that comes up when you type in data. So I assume that's what data looks like. You then do an embarrassingly parallel job for some sort of ETL step, right? Maybe you're taking in text documents and extracting out word counts, these sorts of things, right? And that's often, you know, kind of on a per datum, per document basis. Then you probably do some sort of featureization, right? You extract out interesting features from that data. Some of that is maybe domain knowledge. Some of that is maybe using various non-parametric techniques. But then you want to do some sort of machine learning, right? And unfortunately, most people, the machine learning algorithms that they want to run are not embarrassingly parallel, right? They often, you know, this is, again, if you Google machine learning diagram and pull up image search, you get this lovely example of multiple workers communicating with some sharded data through some parameter server. They're these big kind of complicated, hard distributed problems. So in the framework we've been talking about, the question is, how do you give Jeff Bezos money to solve this problem, right? And it's challenging because while the first two are a great PyWren fit, right? This last one, because it's distributed, because it's at scale, because you want some TensorFlow distributed deep PySpark ML based whatever, many, many buzzwords, you end up with a very sad Jeff Bezos. And so we thought, well, what if we could fix this through reduce, right? What if we could like kind of dynamically spin up a large cluster of machines to do whatever computing you wanted behind the scenes? But then we remembered this quote in this paper from Frank McSherry, which says, you can have a second computer when you've shown you know how to use the first one. And Frank McSherry, a computer science researcher, wrote this great paper called Scalability, But What at What Cost? And you may have seen the blog post version of this. It was very high profile. I have a real soft spot in my heart for brilliant academics who like to troll the rest of the academic community. And he went through and took a lot of the results from recent papers using technology like Spark or GraphLab or GraphX, and he said, okay, on these large data sets where you have these systems running on machines with 16 cores or 128 cores, they get some performance on either a Twitter corpus or these other corpora. What if I just try and write fast, single-threaded code on my laptop to do the same dang thing? And he found that in a shocking number of cases, if you actually just wrote your single-threaded code well, you could beat these large-scale distributed systems, right? So the overhead here on these large-scale distributed systems can be tremendous, right? And that's interesting. You say, okay, well, maybe these regimes, maybe these distributed systems scale to better regimes. But for most of us, we're not in the Google, Facebook, or Twitter regime with our data, right? In fact, surveys from Yahoo as of 2015, I think, show that the average Hadoop job size run at Yahoo was 15 gigabytes, right? So most of us are not kind of trying to process everyone's likes or, you know, everyone's emails if you're the NSA. Most of us are in kind of a much more pedestrian regime. And so you say, well, maybe I just want to do all my reduces on a single machine, right? Frank McSherry suggests that I can do actually a shocking amount of machine learning and algorithmic work on a big machine. And you say, well, but I don't have a big machine. I mean, I have a laptop, but I don't have one of these giant servers. But again, that's where Jeff Bezos comes in. So Amazon has recently started offering truly fantastically impressive pieces of hardware that you can rent literally by the hour, right? The X1.32X large machine has 2 terabytes of RAM and 64 cores, and you can get it for $14 per hour. And that's a shocking amount of distributed computing capability all in one machine with an amazing amount of bandwidth. Similarly, if you're trying to do various deep learning approaches, right, you can get one of these 16 GPU machines from Amazon for, again, $14 an hour. And you know, the $14, even as a postdoc who, you know, you can imagine what they pay us living in the uncanny valley between graduate student and faculty, $14 is not that much. And so we built this, and this is something we're releasing soon in PyWren, the ability to kind of do this large scale reduction, right? We can call reduce with just a simple reduce function that does exactly what you'd expect it to, right? The interface here is, again, what you hope from MapReduce. And this spins up one of these large instances in the background, runs whatever data you need to, and then shuts it back down, right? One of the things we run into, I want to say that perhaps everyone is susceptible to this, although it may be due to our large number of graduate students, is it's very easy on Amazon to accidentally leave machines up. And we take care of all of that for you. So transparently in the background, again, your existing Python, the Python that you've been calling for a long time, along with all your home-built modules, along with all your dependencies, gets kind of combined and sent off to that machine using the same runtime that we're using for Lambda. We can even do crazier things. So one of the very bright graduate students in our group whose name you might recognize from the Spark commit logs everywhere, I think if you run spark-ec2, the launching script, that is his script. Shiram said, well, what if we try actually seeing just via Lambda if we can replicate these sorts of distributed computing infrastructures? Let's try setting up a parameter server. And so what we did was Amazon also, you get the feeling I'm kind of a big AWS fan, they offer a service called Elastic Cache, which will give you a Redis server, right, a key value server on their end. And just, again, spin it up dynamically. You don't have to worry about any of this. And we tried using that as a parameter server, and we found that we can get up to roughly 1.2 million transactions per second to that thing from a large number of Lambda workers. And again, this is because we think we can even get this number higher. But what that suggests is that maybe these sorts of stateless kind of functions, this serverless approach, might actually work for more interesting kind of large-scale distributed systems beyond just what I'm talking about today. Now, I know many people here, and as Dwayne alluded to, I started and sold a startup to Salesforce before going back into academia. And lots of people actually, you know, don't love Amazon as much as I do, or for various reasons, ranging from regulatory to infrastructure to costs, that have their own private, what people call a private cloud, or we used to just call a data center. And so AWS isn't a good fit, but fortunately, kind of, vendors such as Kubernetes are increasingly paying attention to this kind of serverless model. In fact, somewhat fortuitously, at the beginning of last week, Kubernetes announced Fission. And so Fission is basically, if you have a cluster running a containerization orchestration framework like Kubernetes, Fission gives you basically your own private AWS Lambda. So you can start using, again, this kind of paradigm for running your tasks, but locally. So our hope is that PyWren makes scale a little bit easier, right? It provides a real, what we think of as useful hook for all of our collaborators. And in fact, we had one of our physics collaborators say, hey, look, if you can run my code across 1,000 machines, I will rewrite everything in Python, because that sounds amazing. And that's exactly what we're going for. And we hope that kind of many people in the community are in that regime. So if you have a Python function and you want to scale it, we have the GitHub project up and running. Soon we'll have a Conda package. I was racing last night, but did not manage to make that happen. Don't tell Travis. We have the map functionality we've been talking about introduced today, the kind of big reduce functionality we're releasing hopefully this week when I get back. And this parameter server stuff I was talking about is still all highly experimental. But the goal here, again, is this kind of scale, because we also found that many of you who have written Python have actually gotten very good at writing kind of reasonably fast Python, right? As Dwayne was saying, not only can you kind of, not only is that Python's reputation for being, in some sense, interpreted languages reputation for being slow not true, but in fact, you can also often get a lot of, there are a lot of tweaks you can do to make them even faster. So if you can write fast, single-threaded code, this, I think, is a reasonable way of scaling to these regimes. And that's basically it. I have a couple of both Shivram's and my collaborator, and Ben and Jan have been very patient with us trying this insane, crazy thing where we said, hey, look, we want to take this thing designed for microservices and really abuse it and make it do all sorts of crazy stuff. And it seems to be working. And that's it. Any questions, I guess? I think there was that. Yes. They're actually, they seem to be incredibly happy with this. I think this was actually a use case that they were not originally anticipating, but my friends at, so I wrote a few blog posts before giving this talk and before we wrote the paper on this. And then Jeff Barr, who's one of Amazon's kind of chief technology evangelists, was happily retweeting it. So they're actually, I joke, but they're very much aware. And I think that while, I think while this might be a regime that they didn't originally plan on focusing on, I think they're very interested in it. My bet, actually, so as you saw early, there are some constraints on what these lambdas can do, right? There's kind of finite runtime, and you know we've engineered some workarounds for those sorts of things, but I really think this is the future, and I think Amazon feels that way as well. Every indication we've gotten from them suggests that kind of the limits on things like lambda runtime or memory availability are only going to go up in the future. Similarly, the other cloud providers like Google and Microsoft seem to be moving kind of in that direction. But no, I have not. I've got no nasty emails from anyone at all, but rather lots of retweets. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Could you give some more examples of the basic functions that can be used in Lambda? And just to clarify, the slide with the 6 megs per second or something, was that like a gradient descent? Is that an example of one of those functions?
Right. So So remember, what Lambda is going to do is take functions that you currently run serially, right, and just run a large number of them simultaneously. So it's not really a great fit if you're trying to run, say, a large-scale distributed gradient descent, right? If you're trying to do like mini-batch SGD over large amounts of data, I think it's not a great fit for that. What it is a better fit for are if you're trying to run gradient descent on, so one of the hyperparameter tuning optimization that I didn't talk about was doing gradient descent for a particular type of robust Kalman filter, right? And there what we had was a very kind of numerically optimized single-threaded gradient descent, or SGD implementation, that was running and kind of searching, and then we spawned a bunch of them across a bunch of different parameter settings. But so I think it's important to kind of split here the algorithms for which something like Lambda is a good fit, right? Which are right now kind of single-threaded or embarrassingly parallel task, which then maybe on the other side have a large gather reduce step involved from the code that you can run, and kind of any, literally any Python function that you can write will happily run inside this containerized runtime. And the beauty of Anaconda means, so our serialization technology doesn't do a great job, I say R as if it was mine, the serialization technology out there doesn't do a great job with handling compiled Python modules, but fortunately, Anaconda has taken care of almost all of that for you behind the scenes. Does that answer your question? Great, awesome.
Yep. Hey, is there any concern about security with returning a pickled object and unpickling it?
So in general, yes. Do not do this if you do not trust the person on the other end. Here, I trust Amazon an awful lot. I think many of us do, but that is, I mean, it is true. You should in general not unpickle things from untrusted sources. It depends a lot on what your threat model is, right? So if you're running something like, say, the Kubernetes service where other people in your organization or maybe people you don't have control over have access to these machines, then that's potentially a risk. But that you also, you know, there are a lot of security worms there. We haven't, because Pickle tends to be incredibly fast and also kind of support everything in the Python ecosystem, we really haven't explored alternative serialization technologies for that reason. One thing that I think bears mentioning is that the Kubernetes or the containerization service that's used, right, is Amazon works really hard to make sure that like your lambdas are not running in a container next to someone else's lambdas. So I think this is basically as secure as any other part of the AWS ecosystem. Any other questions? Yes, sir. So, I mean, right, so he asked, could this be a potential replacement for HPC workloads? So for HPC is jargon describing kind of high-performance computing, so it's generally people think of kind of actual supercomputers with, you know, interconnects like Mirinet or InfiniBand. And yes and no. I mean, the reason it's called PyWren is because a wren is a very small bird, right? Unlike Condor, which is a batch process system that's often used to coordinate jobs on those clusters. But the HPC workloads that people have are generally kind of at the as far in the other end of the big data spectrum as they could be, right? They're running large, dense kind of per voxel simulations of things like computational fluid dynamics, Maxwell's equations, these sorts of things. And so, and we do kind of a shocking amount of that, right? But this is kind of on the other end, right? Where we're trying to target these sorts of single-threaded jobs. That said, the infrastructure that we built, and we're starting to play around with this on the kind of big reduced side, also lets us spin up kind of arbitrary ad hoc collections of AWS machines to then run lambdas on them. And so what we're exploring is, because a lot of those traditional HPC workloads are done on GPUs now, right, including all of our own, so we work with problems like MRI or seismic inversions, any of these things that traditionally needed kind of supercomputers, we all do it on GPUs. Lambda doesn't support GPUs, but it's very easy to spin up your own cluster of GPUs on Amazon on the back end. And because the serialization technology works so well, like you can then kind of serialize your TensorFlow objects, send it over there, and it runs. So we're hoping to kind of get to a middle point there, but you know, on the we're not going to be able to touch anything they're doing at NERST or wherever for a while. All right, thank you.